the bed, but she was trying to pop them up. She dropped the bed, but she's still in critical condition. And they got her under watch for 14 days. Watch meaning she could have possibly had a stroke because she had a brain bleed. And they said that they're going to watch her for 14 days. I know a man.
Amen.
I know a man that changes things. He's already changed things for her. He's already changed things for many of you in here tonight. We've got to put our trust in him. I told her when we got to the church, we would have a special prayer for her.
Yeah.
And that's what we're going to do. We're going to start a song. We're going to have a special prayer for
her. Amen.
She also told me to tell everyone that she loves you and that she sure misses coming to church. And she's really sad that she's having to miss this revival. And that's the kind of zeal we got to have. I've always felt that way. When the church doors open, I get excited. I want to go.
Amen.
And I think that's how we need to enter in to the house of God. With joy.
Amen.
With thanksgiving.
Yes, sir.
So if everybody would, just pray right where you are, but let's go to the Lord on Mildred's behalf and ask God to touch her and bring her out that ICU. Amen. You're talking 14 days. I believe God can bring her out there quicker than that, don't you?
Amen.
Amen.
But also include
Jamie Luke
and his family
on
this.
Yeah.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord on this. Heavenly Father, we come to you.
God bless
you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for this opportunity to come to the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for everything you do. Lord, our lives, Lord, we have all the power. We pray in our hearts.
Once again, we'd like to welcome everybody in the name of the Lord. We've already had a great time today. We went down to the water hole, baptized three this morning. We don't want to stop there. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we invite you to get to know him tonight. And if you're already a Christian and say you've sort of slipped a little bit, all you got to do is say, Lord, forgive me.
Amen. That's right.
Renew that. That's what we had. We had
Amen.
Some renewing ourselves tonight in the Lord, and it's just awesome. Our Lord is always there to forgive.
That's right.
He said he'd never leave us nor forsake us. He'd go with us all the way to the
Amen.
End.
Right.
I know that definitely would be true, because I've had some pretty bad ups and downs at times, you know, with sickness and stuff. I'm standing here today to tell you I feel great in the Lord. And so at this time, if we will, all the choir, everybody will come up. Let's get a couple of songs. And let's get right into service. And once again, we want you to know this altar is open the whole service. You don't have to wait for a special call. But when you feel in your heart that you need to pray, come on up. We'll meet you.
Give me your hand, let's agree together that all of our enemies crumble at our feet. For whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven at the name of Jesus. We've got the power in the name of Jesus. stop us, but the Church of Jesus is still alive. We're like a mighty army, we keep marching onward.
Thank you. boys got it. I guess it's that, I've seen all the damn words here, and I've been very, guys like that, I get stoned down there. I wouldn't get back home. With you, I wouldn't want to talk to both of you. I took my own mom.
Right. Lord tonight, love each and every one of you. I don't know if anyone has an unspoken request, but let's leave it to me. We have a spoken request tonight, you'd like to take right now. If you remember Northern Park, that man, rough time. His case or your family, he said he just laid his arm to you. Remember Charlie and Reed?
Yes, they were.
And remember Ricky Matthews and his granddaughter. But anyways, remember Dave Matthews, my brother.
Amen. I invite Ricky up to the revival. He said, you might see him. I said, I hope I do, brother. I said, I miss him on the first one. Someone else?
I'll go to a friend of mine, bring her up today. She's at a family in Huntington that lost their mother of a heart attack. And they're very poor. And then the son, OD, or the poor patient, was there 2 days later. Names McDaniel, God knows who they are.
Amen.
She said they were really in need of prayer to all the way down to the mother, the daughter, and it's all the family needed to be had. So remember them in prayer. And I finally got some kids back, which was good. But they told me I had 90% blockage in the right side of my mouth. And I want church to pray for me.
Amen.
I'm nervous about it. I'm scared because, you know, he went to tell me all this, and I thought, just shut up, I don't want to hear it. But he said he didn't have to cut my neck. He could go into it with the skin. But just remember me in prayer. I'm waiting on the appointment for that. And I'm going to go to this pain clinic for years. Well, I could tell him I think I need another opinion. So I went to a doctor in Huntington, and he looked at X-rays, checked me, and he said, well, I know you're having pain in your back. And he said, I think a lot of your problem is your hip. So, you know, you just don't know what to do. I'm going to put it all in the Lord's hands and put my faith in him. And remember my kids in prayer. Remember Mike and Marissa. And Mike, he has travel out of town now to work.
That's your Lord.
Job. And also I went to church to remember Larry and Stacy and Chris.
Amen.
Amen.
And I just want to say I love the Lord. I'm glad to be here tonight. And I told the Lord, and I think I said, I'm looking for a place.
Bless your Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Just keep me in your prayers.
Your pleasure.
Bob Steele, Brother Bob Steele, because there's always a lot of problems on what it is. And remember Ann, kidney level go back up, and stress is coming down, and sure, get better off. Remember Ann, that he'll get you stronger, and him son and Ann all going to go back out to church.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Someone else? Brother Rob?
Keep praying for Rocky and Kendall. Pray for Autumn, I'm glad she got to church first.
Yes, me too. Always glad.
Also glad to see Luther and Nicky too.
Yes, sir.
Pray for the preacher tonight. Amen. Pray for the unsaved, and sure, most of all. This is what this is all about.
Amen.
It's to see the unsaved to come out, hear the gospel preaching, give their life over to the Lord, because time is running out so fast.
Yeah.
On this generation, on this world, time is coming to an end fast. I mean, even the sinners, Lord, they would see that. That what's happening in this world today, they've heard preached all their life, and now it's coming to pass. Shouldn't be shocked about it, shouldn't be amazed about it. They should say, well, I was told it was coming, and now's the time. Today's the day of salvation.
Amen.
Now's the time to give your life over to the Lord. While there's still time. Right now, God is still calling the unsaved out. He still wants to save people.
Yes, he is.
But there's coming a time when that mercy door is going to be shut. Yep. And I don't care how much crying and begging and praying and pleading with God, you do. It ain't going to do any no good.
Amen.
When God says that's it, that's it. So please, get in now while you still can. Yeah. Not out of door tonight.
Yeah. Lord.
You too.
I was just
going to
ask the church to continue to pray for my hands. I'm
pray for my friend Leah that's lost. Carrie and I both invited her to church tonight, and she said she's not coming tonight, but she may come one or two nights this week. So just pray that the Lord will continue to work on her, and pray for both my boys that are lost.
Amen.
But Randy, I'd like to give you a new prayer. I'd like for y'all to remember all. She goes Tuesday evening to be put in the hospital to get the inbox for labor for her to have the baby. So I asked you all to pray. He weighs 5 pounds and 11 ounces now. And just pray that everything will go well with her. I know it is. And you know, I've already left it in the Lord's hands.
Amen.
And I want y'all to pray. So I know you all been praying for, you know, people say, well, how can you know we're praying? Well, you know, when I ask this church to pray, I feel in my heart that you all are praying.
Amen.
And I'd like to ask you all to remember my home, that it'll be my home in prayer before it's too late. Remember my grandchildren and my son and my daughter. And remember Ashley, the 11th will be 4 years that she's lost her mom. And she's going through a real bad time right now, and I'd like to all really pray for her.
Amen.
She's getting depressed, and she's having a little bit of anxiety, and I just ask you all to really pray for her. I put on there, you know, that I love her, and I will always love her, no matter what.
Bless the Lord.
But she needs the Lord in her life, most of all, that, you know, the Lord will lead, guide, and direct her in the things that she needs to do. But she'll always be, I always told her she was my daughter when Matthew married her. And she'll always be my daughter. And
amen.
I'd like for you all to really pray for her, that God will touch her. She's got a beautiful voice to sing. And, you know, she gets on there with those, I don't know what you call it. It's like with Travis Trent and all of them. And she'll sing along with them, buddy. And she can get right down with all of that stuff. And I thought, Lord, I wish I had a voice like she's got. But I've got the voice that the Lord gave me.
That's right. Amen.
You know, I'm glad to be here tonight. I was sick in body this morning, but... And then I started the church, and my stomach was all messed up, and I thought, now, okay, I said, now, devil, you're just going to have to get right when you need to be. I said, oh, I'm going to church tonight.
Bless you.
I didn't go to Sunday school this morning. I said, I'm going to church
bless
tonight.
Your Lord.
And I like for you all to pray for Violet when you pray, and remember my other sister who lives up out there, and she's real sick, and she don't get to come out to church like she wants to, and I like for y'all to really remember her. She has a rough time. God knows all about it, and the Lord knows what she goes through.
Yeah.
Every day of her life, not only with her sickness, but with other things that she has to take and put up with God.
Yeah.
You know, she's a good person. She doesn't do anything to hurt nobody. She doesn't say anything about anybody. What she speaks is the truth, usually about somebody. She doesn't gossip about people. And I really ask you all to pray for her. And just remember me that I always be found good and what I need to do. And you know, pray that maybe one night this week that Roger will come to church with
Amen.
Me.
Yeah.
And, you know, they come up with all kinds of excuses. But, you know, like I told them one time before, I said, well, you're going to run out of excuses, and then there ain't going to be no more than what you're going to do. But I kind of need to draw the light to them the best that I know how to do. And live my life before my family, that they would see that there's a reality in the service, a true living God.
Amen.
And I just ask you all to remember me when you pray. I think I'm having a little bit of issue with my pancreas again, but I ask you all to pray that the Lord will help me out and come to this revival.
Amen.
I don't want to be in the hospital, and I don't want to be sick, Rod.
Right.
And I want to be here. And I asked you all to pray for me.
We will.
Someone else.
Okay, my sister-in-law's been in the hospital, often in the hospital now, they last month and a half, 2 months, they transferred her to a nursing home. And she's just not doing good at all, and my other sister-in-law told me that they was afraid that she'd give up. She hasn't seen none of the family now in almost 3 months. They won't let me down there to see, all it is a bus, you know, by phone, and she's quit talking like any of us at the city. Her ex-husband, which took care of her. But remember Patty in prayer that God would touch us, and really part of us, I know we can't do this this week. And pray for David, for her ex-husband, because he has been a godsend. I've already took care of her now for the last 4 years. You know, you don't find many people like that. Remember my nephew that lives in Ohio, my sister-in-law told me that he'd been off of alcohol. With all this COVID, the stress has come to make a living, he went back to the alcohol. Just pray that when he takes a drink, that God will turn his mouth so bitter that he thinks then. But continue, like I said, to pray for me. I love the Lord, and I know I'm standing here running my mouth, but remember doing what he says to me.
Praise the Lord. God bless you.
I just want to say that I love the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I was talking to my husband and my daughter here. I said, I'm in church. And it was probably 15 minutes after that main hearing message meeting. Told me that now we're having a revival here.
Praise the Lord.
I think it was a sign that this is where God does it. Remember me and my family, remember my husband. That God will enter into the heart. I would love for my whole family, for me, my husband, my two girls, to walk hand in hand.
I'm so blessed to have someone like that to do something.
Praise the Lord.
I'm telling you, you said like, that is what you call the brother. I'm telling you. I love the Lord. I love what he's done for me. I'm telling you. Some people don't understand what we're here for tonight. Well, if they don't, then they're missing out. I'm here to serve the Lord, to praise him, give him the glory and honor for everything he deserves. I'm telling you, I want to make heaven my home. I'm not perfect. I'm never going to be perfect. Y'all hear me say it all the time. I'm not going to be perfect here. There's coming a day that I'm going to leave this whole world. And when I leave, I'm going to go and be able to see the one that died for me. Hey, that's the best thing I can tell anybody. Love, he is the one that died for you and me. So thankful for what he did. I tell you, the only one who could have done anything like that was Jesus. And I'm so thankful that he did. Love the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Anybody else with a request? This is Bob.
Y'all can remember my mother.
Bless the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
Brother Andy. I'd like the church to remember Sarah and Walker Gibson in this prayer.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Spirit of Scripture tonight,
Dr. Yes, it is. Let's take his request to the Lord. You know, one scripture in the Bible says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves to pray, then will I hear from heaven. That's not all the scripture, but that's all the Lord wants me to say. But let's go to the Lord in prayer and let's hear from heaven on these requests.
Amen. Heavenly Father,
we're thankful, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Brother Kevin up to sing, we'd like to know if you want to have a testimony on your heart. Amen. Brother Kevin.
How are you?
Y'all stand up in prayer for Brother Kevin. Pray that God's anointing upon him.
Amen.
Wakes you up in the morning and just see another day. You just want to just say thank you, Lord, for another day. Thank you, God, for being there. Thank you for just everything that you do. I love you all. Just pray for my family.
Anyone else?
All right.
try this little glass house you got off the table.
Last time it messed up a little bit. We've used it again since then. I'd like it to work.
Yeah, this is more.
It not work. We'll block it back up. Mostly, I guess, for James. He asked me to do this one, so. He likes his songs.
When I see the sunrise in the morning, when I feel the wind blow across my face, when I hear the sound of children playing, I know it's all part of God's amazing grace. I believe there's a place called heaven. I believe in a place called Calvary. I believe in a man's name is Jesus. That he gave his life for me.
You believe that tonight? Thank you, Lord.
I was there the day my loved one went to heaven. I held
mountains and
our way. But right here in this moment, may our strength be renewed as we recall what God has done and how we've seen Him move. If there's anybody here who has found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's able, say, if there's anybody here who has seen His power, anybody here walk through the fire, say, amen. Anybody here found joy in the middle of sorrow, just say, amen. Sometimes through the darkness, it's hard to see. Oh, but just be brave and follow where He leads. For greater is the one who's in us than He who's in the world. The battle is the Lord's. If there's anybody here who has found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's able, say amen. If there's anybody here who has seen His power, anybody here brought through the fire, say amen. Anybody here to hear him calling, call me God. Hey. You know, I've been caught on all the wrong things in my lifetime, and to be honest with you, smart wasn't off one of them. But thank God I was smart enough for the things one night, called Jesus Christ, the Lord of my life. You know, I caught a quiz to a whole lot of sinners. But it's because of that commitment, a lot of people will laugh at us. They'll call us fools. I'll let them go ahead and laugh. You see, that don't really bother me at all. Because even a fool can see by the senses in this old world just about to fall. Just as long as we let Jesus call them shots, I ain't got nothing at all to fear. When that roll is called Gunner, don't call me, because I ain't going to be here. Are you going with me tonight? Hey, amen. I'm going home one day. Amen. You can call me God. I believe and call me God. You'll be grieving if you're left here. For me to hear him call me God. Yeah, when Jesus calls for me, you can call me God.
I'm not going to be left behind. I don't know about anybody else. I'm going home with Jesus. I'm not going to be left behind. When that roll is caught up yonder, that try hear the trumpet sound, I'm leaving here one day after a while. I'm going to try to shut up and get out of the way, but I'm leaving here, and I'm thankful that I got a heaven to gain and a hell to serve, Brother James. He gave us a promise when he went to the cross and he shed his blood for my sins. He shed his blood for your sins. He shed his blood for your sins, Brother King. Brother Larry just came back and rededicated his life to the Lord this morning. He shed his blood for his sins. You know what? He's got the same reward. He got the same reward Brother Andy's had here. He's been serving the Lord for 40-some years. He got the same reward awaiting him one day after a while, because he said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you so. He went to prepare a place for us, and it's ready. I believe it's ready, Brother Bobby. I believe that place is ready. One thing is all that's got to happen. There's only one thing that's got to happen. It's for the Father to look over and say, son, go get them. Go get my children. Go get them. It's done. It's over with. It's time to go get him. I believe he's getting sick of the way things are going in this world. I believe he's just about had enough. And one day after a while, we're going home. It may be before Bobby even gets up here. It can be that quick. Y'all believe we're that close? You look around what's going on in the world. We're that close, church. We are that close. We can look towards that eastern sky, which is that direction. I've always told you that. That's east. That's east. We can look to that eastern sky and see the clouds split. Jesus will split the clouds wide open.
Yeah.
I'd love to see that, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
I'd love to see that. I'm going to get out of Bobby's way. He's going to have he's gonna preach the word here in a minute. I'm going to get out of his way, but I'm happy tonight. I'm happy I'm going home.
Romans chapter 10 and verse 13 says, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
Don't think that you're unsavable tonight. Don't think that you can't be saved. This altar is open for you. This service is for you. And this service for anybody who needs the Lord in their life.
Amen.
Let's make welcome, Brother Bob.
Amen.
Ain't no jealousy here. We had church this morning.
Amen.
I know people come out and they thought they was coming out to Sunday school. Basically, you did. But we had church.
Amen.
She mentioned back there, she came and gave her life back to the Lord this morning.
Amen.
Well, Amen. Said, went down to the water hole, baptized three people.
Yep.
I'm telling you, God is good.
Amen.
He been better to me than I have to him.
Amen.
I said, he's been better to me than I have to him. He's been better to me than I have to him. I'm trying, I'm striving, I'm praying, Lord, make me what you would have me to be.
Amen.
Sometimes this old flesh is enmity. All the time it's enmity, according to the Bible. Sometimes it gets in the way, and we just don't do what the Spirit tells us to do. But I'm striving harder and harder to let God guide what he wants me to do.
Bless the Lord.
What he wants me to say.
Bless the Lord.
We just got revealed something over there in the seat that we want to share with you. Yeah, God changed the message a little bit. And I'm going to read one verse out of chapter 4 of St. John. And that's verse 10. If you want to stand for the reading of God's word, that's fine. If you don't, that's fine. Verse 10 in chapter 4 of St. John. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that said to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldst have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. You may be seated. And the thought that I want to use for tonight is, if thou knewest. If thou knewest. There's a whole lot of people in hell tonight. Y'all believe that?
Amen.
Scripture said that it's enlarging its borders every day. And it's rising up to meet people at their coming because they are rejecting the only begotten Son of God. Hell is enlarging its borders. But if they only knew. If you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus, if you only knew who this man really was. We can't comprehend the height, nor the depth, nor the width of the Lord Jesus Christ, but if you only knew what he could do for you tonight. If you only knew how he could change your thoughts, how he could change your situation, how he could change your state of mind. I'm sure that when Mitch come to Sunday school this morning or come into the house of God, a lot of things were weighing heavy upon her. Matter of fact, you could see it on her face. She was worried and concerned about a lot of things. But as the service went on and the Holy Spirit began to deal with her, she knew. She got up and she said, I know what I need to do. And I really believe that she was prepared to sit back in her seat and not do what God wanted her to do. The Spirit was speaking to her. And I ain't never left this pulpit and went back and sit down beside of somebody and tried to convince them to come unless the Spirit was really on me heavy. But that morning, or this morning I should say, the Lord spoke to me and he said, go tell her you don't have time to play around with this. When God is calling, that is the time to answer. Now is the day of salvation. This is the appointed time. And when you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Listen to me today. There's no time to walk lost and undone without Jesus. Time is running out on you. And the Lord is coming back. How many believes he's coming back? The Lord is coming back soon and very soon. How soon, Brother Bob? Hey, listen, I'm going to tell you what Jesus said real quick. And then we're going to get back to some of this. Jesus said to the disciples one time that in the last before the coming of the Son of Man, and there would be wars and rumors of wars. How many see that going on all around us? Today would be famines and pestilence and earthquakes and divers places. Do you know North Carolina had an earthquake this morning? There's famines all over the land. There's starvation. I saw something on Facebook down in the town of Logan that I never thought I would see. They had bathtubs set up down there on the courthouse square and were baptizing many people. I shouted with my spirit when I saw that, because glory to God for allowing those people to get permission from the official to do that for the glory of God. And I believe that it's changing lives, don't you? People, we better hold on to God with all of our strength. If thou knewest the gift of God. What is the gift of God? What is the gift of God? Eternal life. Eternal life. If thou knewest the gift of God and who it was that said give me drink, you'd ask of him and he'd give you living water. I don't know about you, but I and the gift that he can give you. You ask of him. Did I not say to you this morning, you don't have it because you haven't asked? When she come down to the altar and kneel down and ask God to help her through what she was going through and to forgive her of her sin, he was right there immediately. And you know what? He was there all the time, bitch. He was there all the time. Mary, he was there all the time. Thank God, son. I mean for you to really thank God that he didn't give up on you. He didn't give up on you. The Christians didn't give up on you. The church didn't give up on you. The Holy Spirit kept working with you. And I'm sure you can correct me if I'm wrong. The whole time that you maybe was away from the church just a little bit, there was condemnation come to you. Every time that the church grew up, somebody told me one time, you know what? I don't have to go to church, but I go because I want to. Well, I go because I want to, but I have to go to church.
Amen.
Y'all didn't get that.
Amen.
Y'all be fair, bro.
If I didn't go to church, I'd starve to death on TV dinners. TV dinners never did fill me up anyway. Well, I like to come to the house of God where you can hug a brother. I like to come to the house of God where you can shake someone's hand.
Yeah.
I like to come to the house of God where you can pat somebody on the back and say, "Hey, good job on that song." I like to have that fellowship with my brother and sister, don't you? Heaven ain't going to be a little corner over here and a corner over there.
That's right.
I ain't going to put up a big screen TV and say, "This is what heaven means." God wants us to be a family.
Amen.
We got a brother right here that on, what is this, the 8th or the 9th?
9th.
And on the 9th, we was going to start revival at 7 o'clock in the afternoon. Well, I want you to know God changed that. God changed that. He started that revival 2 weeks ago on a Tuesday. God started the revival that night.
Thank the Lord.
But he talked to her heart and told her, "You're missing too much church."
Yeah, yeah.
You don't mind me saying this, do you? When he spoke to her and said, "Don't fall in to that group of people that had lost their desire to go to church. Don't fall into that category to where you don't care what's going on anymore. You're going to do whatever you want to do."
All right, Lord.
God spoke to her heart and brought her to prayer meeting that night. And she got up and did a confession that she was slack on the Lord and wanted God to forgive her for it.
Yeah. Amen.
Well, let me tell you, the moment she said that, the moment she said that, her blessings come back. The moment she said, "Lord, I don't want to fall into that congregation that don't care if they go or not," the glory about to start coming back. The church rejoiced. Heaven rejoiced. She got it right. She's here, ain't she? That's all we got to do. Let me say this real quick. Can I throw this thing? Let me say this real quick. There's no shame. I don't care if you've been in church for 50 years. There's no shame in walking down that aisle and going down and going down. When we got too much pride and we want to sit on the seat and say, "I don't care. People think I'm backslid. People do it. People laugh at me. People talk to me." That's the shame. It's letting the flesh hinder you from doing what the Spirit wants you to do.
Amen.
If you only knew, can I reveal something to you that the devil will not reveal to you? You keep running out of church. And pretty soon you won't want to go to church no more. You keep laying out of church, and pretty soon you won't miss church no more. You keep laying out, pretty soon you'll start saying the things you used to say before you got saved. You keep laying out of church, and pretty soon, and I'm talking to anybody that might watch this video too, you keep laying out of church, you better heed the warning. It's not me speaking, it's the Holy Spirit speaking through me, and the Holy Spirit is telling me to say this. If you keep laying out of church, you're going to get cold, and you're going to die. I'm not talking about a natural death, I'm talking about a spiritual death. You'll die. You'll fall out with the church. Keep playing out.
Amen.
And Satan will have you. He's got you where he wants you now, but he wants you to backslide. He wants you to quit. He wants you to look at that video and say, well, that crazy preacher, he ain't got no right to judge me. I'm so mad at him, I'll never go back in. That's what he wants. Look the devil in the eye. Do it with me now. Look the devil in the eye and say, you're not getting me. You're not going to tear me down. I'm making my own back to my house. Look him in the eye. Church, if you're in here today, if you've grown cold, if you ain't feeling nothing, if you go to church time and time and time again and you can't feel nothing, if all you want to do is look at the preacher and judge and criticize, all you want to do is gripe and complain about the church, gripe and complain about the church, you might think, well, this is not a very good revival service. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It's long overdue for pastors and preachers to tell the congregation, quit crying and complaining and start shouting and rejoicing. Quit this. Pick your brother and sister up. Tell them you love them.
Amen.
Tell them you enjoy their song. Tell them you enjoy their testimony. Don't scoff. Don't you know that's one of the signs of the end? There would be scoffers.
Yeah.
Walking after their own ungodly lust.
Yeah.
People say, oh, I can preach better than you can. I can sing better than you can. I can do it better than you can. Well, do it then.
Yeah.
If you can do it, do it. We need to get right. And not what I'm talking about is that we need to get it right. Do it God's way.
Yep.
Amen. Right. Amen. We need to quit trying to do things our way. Right. And do it God's way.
Amen. That's right.
If you Amen. Knew who it was, if you only knew, keep that thought in your mind, will you? If you only knew,
Amen.
Jesus, my friend, is a God, or the Son of the living God, that loves you
yep.
and sticks closer to you
Bless
than
God.
A brother.
Yep. Yep.
He is one that made the promises. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will go with you all the way, even until the end of the world.
Amen.
He's the one that said, I will make a way where there seems to be no way.
That's right.
Is everybody in here a Christian tonight? Everybody a Christian?
Yes, you are.
If you ain't ashamed of it, let me know. Everybody a Christian tonight?
Amen.
But we can't be ashamed of it. If we are, then up here's where we need to be.
That's right. Amen.
Listen to this. Listen. The Lord hath made us some promises. Kevin quoted some of it. I quoted it this morning. In the 14th chapter of St. John, in my father's house are many mansions.
That's right.
And we're not so overtaken. I'm going to go and prepare a place for him.
Amen.
If I go and prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to receive you. And then he said over in Thessalonians, he said the Lord himself is going to descend from heaven. With the voice of an archangel. Boy, that means when that archangel cries out, you give attention to that, don't you?
Amen. Amen.
That voice is so loud it'll wake the dead.
Yeah,
he's going to have the trump of God in his hand. He's going to declare dead in Christ come forth.
Yeah.
See, he promised before the patriarchs, before the disciples, before our family members and our forefathers and the forerunners of this gospel, before they even died, they had a promise in them. You know what Joseph said? Joseph was one of the sons of Jacob. Yeah, sons of Jacob. And he said, when you leave Egypt, take my bones with you. I wonder how he could say that. He had a promise. Yeah. He knew that God was going to deliver them out of the land of Egypt. Said, when you leave here, take my bones with you and bury them in the Holy Land. Take them to the land of promise. Take them to the milk and honey. Well, I want you to know something. Jesus is not going to leave us in the grave either.
No.
He's not going to leave us in this Egypt land either.
That's right.
Because when he comes back in the clouds and the dead in Christ come out of there, if I'm sleeping in the graveyard, I hope you're standing by. Especially if you doubt old Bob's going to make it. I hope you're standing by my gravesite when that trumpet sounds and that voice rings out. But I'm going to kick that casket open and I'm coming out of there.
There it is. Yeah.
They may be false feet laid in there. They may be a suit laid in there. They may be shoes laid in there. But I'm coming out of there.
Yeah. There you go.
And you will too if you've got your hope in the Lord. But he made those promises. I'm coming in. I'm going to receive. seem to myself that we're in. If y'all only knew. Now, I said all that to get to this. We go through life, every one of us now, we go through life, and we let the troubles and the cares of this world get us down.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
We let it get us in the valley.
Right.
We let us get discouraged, sometimes depressed. I read a post that one of my nephews put on the other night, how depressed he was and how he felt no one wanted him. No one except to him. He couldn't do nothing right and said he was never good enough for nobody. See, Satan has got him brainwashed. If he only knew.
Yeah.
If he only knew this man called Jesus.
Yeah, amen.
He would know that he has a family that would do anything for him. He has a family that loves him so much. All he has to do is call him. We'll go and wrap our arms around him. If he only knew. If he only knew who it was, sis, that is calling his name.
Yeah.
If he only knew Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm glad I know who Jesus is.
Amen.
I'm glad he knows who I am.
Amen.
I'm glad that he knows how I feel in my heart about Jesus.
Amen.
There's a lot of people that will judge you, right?
Yes.
Don't worry about it. Because God knows you.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people that will criticize you.
Right?
They will. They'll criticize. Don't worry about it. Because God approves you. You have His seal of approval. You walk in the Word of God. You walk in the light of the Lord. And God will approve you. It doesn't matter. I hope that mankind likes me. I try to let people know that I like them and I hope they like me. And I try to do everything I can to be good to everybody. I try to live a good life in front of them, but you're not going to please everybody. You're going to have that person or those persons that's going to walk around and point the finger and judge and criticize and say all manner of evil against you. Oh Lord, here it comes. So, somebody asked me a question one time. When people keep talking about you, don't it make you mad? I said, sure. Makes you mad. It bothers me. Bible said anger but sin not. You see what I gotta do? Jesus said, pray for those that despitefully use you. Pray for those that persecute you.
Amen.
And say all manner of evil against you. Pray for them. And instead of doing, you'll do what? He calls a fire on their head. In other words, Jesus will deal with them.
That's right.
Jesus will deal with them.
That's right.
How many times, Jennifer, did somebody give you a hard time on the job? You come home and tell Mama Kings, Mama, you gotta pray for them people. Man, they're making my life miserable.
Yeah.
If it was a boss, one of them higher-ups, nine out of ten times, they got transferred to another district.
Yeah.
Because a prayer warrior got on her knees.
Yeah.
And said, Father, there's someone causing my daughter stress and harm. And God moved him out of the way.
Yeah.
Moved him out of the way. Transferred him to another district.
Moved him out.
Nine out of ten times that happens. Why? Touch not God's anointing. Touch not God's anointing. Because then God's going to deal with you. Then God's going to take care of you. I'm glad I got Him to fight my back. Every now and then I forget that, don't y'all? Every now and then I forget. I'm supposed to let God fight it, not try to handle it myself. You ever done that? Every now and then, though. It don't happen to nobody else? Every now and then. When somebody says something, you know, there's always that tattletale that his brother tell you what to say about you.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you go hear the brother Roger say, now, Roger won't tell nobody. You won't. He's grinning ear to ear. Can't wait till you leave so he can get on the phone and tell him.
Yeah.
That's just an example, man. Roger. I'll give you a real good example, a personal example. When I first started preaching, there was some people come to my home and they said, Bobby, there's some folks that's going up down the road talking about you. I said, they are. Well, that's good, they're leaving somebody else know. That was my attitude. They said, no, I mean, they're talking about you. And I will go with you and confront them and tell them to their face that they're talking about you. And they can't deny it. I said, listen, the Bible said to pray for people like this. And I'm going to. I'm not going to go to their house. I'm not going to call them out. I'm not going to have a confrontation with them. I'm going to let God deal with it. And God dealt with it. that didn't really bother me at all. A fellow told me one time he was going to knock me out. But I was a pastor. And the only thing I did was ask him, how come his wife's missing so much church? What's the problem? He got mad right then. Take you over to him, boy. Very worth it. I said, well, there was a day when you'd have had to do that, but today I'm going to pray for you. Because that old man is dead. And there's a new man living in this body.
Amen.
I didn't want to fight. I'm a lover, not a fighter. I didn't want to fight. So I prayed for him. And the storm passed. Without physical confrontation. Thank God, because he's a good man. If you only knew, church, if we could only comprehend how great this man Jesus is.
Amen.
We would bring all of our cares and cast them upon the altar.
Right.
We would call out upon him instead of taking matters in our own hands.
Yep.
If we only knew how great Jesus really is, we would come to him with our sickness, with our infirmities, with our financial problems, with the difficulties of life. We would come to him with our marital problems.
Yep.
Now, if it wasn't for God, I know Jennifer would be alone. Y'all say, no, you're easy to get along with your ass cream. Sometimes I am. Sometimes I am. Oh. But we get along great. We really do. But God can help you work out anything.
Yeah.
There's nothing that cannot be worked out. God, I might as well throw it in there. Here it is. It's coming. Two Christians get mad at each other.
Mm-hmm.
Can they work it out, Joey?
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Praise the Lord.
Sure. When both parties want to work it out,
right.
There's nothing that you cannot work out.
Right.
Both parties.
Right.
One side of you, you can't always work it out.
Yeah.
But here's the deal. I don't like the Lord preaching about it, but I'm going to put it out there the way he says it. Here's the deal. If I have an altercation, verbal, with somebody, and I go to them and I apologize to them, and they look me in the eye and say, I ain't forgiving you. I'll take it to my grave. That's between them and God.
Amen.
I done what God told me to do.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
And I have had people say, not to me or about me, but say that they would never forgive people. They would take it to their grave.
Yeah. Amen.
God have mercy is all I can say.
I've said that.
Because if you have an odd against your brother, not going to get into hell.
That's right.
You've got to work it out. You've got to try everything in your power to work it out. If he forgives you, you cover him all through sins. If he don't forgive you, that's on him. You're going to stand before God for you. And nobody else. Nobody else but you. You're the only one who's standing for himself. If you only knew who Jesus was, who is Jesus? Who is this man? Who is this Messiah? Where did he come from? The Son of God? Jesus is the Son of God. And how do we know he's the Son of God?
He said,
read the book of Luke. What did it say in there about the angels? They appeared to Mary first, right?
Yes.
Mary blessed, start there with other women and all that, you know. You're going to conceive, bring forth. And then the host of heaven begin to rejoice and sing. What's his name going to be called?
Jesus.
Emmanuel. God with us. The promised Messiah. The deliverer. The Son of God. Jesus is all in all. He's everything that you need. He's your help in the time of trouble. He's your comforter in the time of sorrow. He's your deliverer when the devil's got you boxed in and you think there's no escape. He's your financial advisor. He's your marriage counselor. He's your friend. He's all in all. He's everything you need. He's your doctor. You see, you don't need to have no fear. These things that you're going through, God's already heard you. He's already got you. Mary, he's already got you. See, you went to the doctor and you found out you had a cataract. and your first thought that Satan put in your head was, you was going blind. When her vision blurred and she couldn't see, she was very distraught. We talked about it, didn't we? I'm afraid I'm losing my eyesight. I'm going blind. I can't even see who's up there in the choir loft. And she went to the doctor and he said, you got cataracts, we can take care of that. See how God works?
Amen.
God is there all in all. Satan will convince you that you're nothing. He'll convince you that the world is against you. He'll convince you the church don't love you. He'll convince you the pastor don't care about you. He'll convince you that you don't need anybody in your life. But you need people in your life. You need people of God in your life. You need to surround yourself with the church. You need to come to the house of God. You need to feel His Holy Spirit. You need to feel the love of the people of God. You need to feel what we feel when we come to God's house. I'm not looking back into the past, but I've been into some organizations or some buildings for other reasons that were ungodly, and I've never been treated with as much love and respect as I have right here in the house of God. Amen. And I've never felt bad in any of those other places that I've kept right here in the house of God.
Amen.
I've never felt so free and so clean and so pure as I feel right here in the house of God.
Amen.
When I leave this house, sometimes the adversary gets on my trail and he tries to convince me of other things. And oftentimes in a weak point, he may get to me a little bit. But when I realize his snare, and that you know, that's what I told Jamie the other night. I said, I'm glad that you realized that Satan was laying a snare for her.
That's right, amen.
He was taking her down the road away from the church, away from the people that loved her, away from the power of God, away from the blessings, away from the learning about God and reading of God's Word and all the things that we get her. Taking her away from all that. Whether you believe this or not, and a lot of people want to argue about it. There's no arguing about it. The Bible says it very plain, do not forsake the assembling themselves together in heavenly places. That's the matter of some is.
Yeah. Right.
If you listen to old John Hagee this morning, boy, he put chills on me when he quoted that scripture and he said, that means even in this day and time, even in the days of the COVID-19, even in the days of the pandemic, don't forsake the house of God.
Amen.
Go to God's house. Get closer to God. Satan desires to sift you as well. He desires to separate you from the church. He desires to separate you from the love of God. He don't want you to read the Word. He don't want you to hear the Word. He don't want you to feel the blessings. He don't want you to have the fellowship that you had when you come to church. He wants to get you away from the church where you're weak and vulnerable, and then He'll match on you. Don't forsake the assembly. The more I think about this thing and the more I pray about it, I done told the whole church here that unless they come with state troopers and throw handcuffs on me, we're going to have church.
Amen.
Bless you,
bro.
Bless you.
I believe I'm making the right comment.
Amen.
If they come up here and padlock the door and they say, you can't have church here no more, you guys stick with me and we'll have church in my front yard if we have to.
Amen.
Forsake the assembling of ourselves together. It may not be here. You may not have a padded pew to sit on, but it's a pew. Stephanie, don't start. But I'll give you a sandrock.
There you go.
My yard is full up. We'll pull up a rock and have a seat. They still laughing. I'm not even going back. Why would y'all do it without me? God wants you to be happy. That's really it. That's really that big for each night so I can make y'all happy. Okay? You may not have a padded pew. I got it. But we will have church.
Yeah.
And you will have a reward in heaven. you'll have something to use when the enemy comes against you. You'll be able to defeat him. How did Jesus defeat the devil? Word of God? With the word of God. You see, the devil took him up on a high mountain, and he said, you see all these cities down here, all these riches, and he's taking, I'll give you every one of them. Did he own them?
No, he didn't own them.
He didn't own them, but he had jurisdiction. At that time in the history of the church, the devil had jurisdiction over the earth. Y'all don't believe that, do you?
Yeah.
He had jurisdiction because grace hadn't come yet. When Jesus defeated the devil, when he got up out of the tomb and he walked out of there and he went down into the heart of the earth and he took the keys to death and hell and the grave away from him, then he had no more power and no more dominion. But up until that point, when he took Jesus up there, he thought he owned it all. He thought he had dominion over it. Because God cast him out and he came down to the earth. And then they said, welcome to the inhabitants of the earth, for the devil's come down among you. And he thought he had dominion over everything. Command these stones that they be made bread. How would you like to go 40 days and nights and not eat a bite? And all of a sudden, somebody said, these stones are made bread. And you may think, I could overcome that. No, you couldn't. You couldn't have overcome it. You couldn't have went through it.
Nope.
You say, yes, I could. All right, what happens when Walmart don't have a loaf of bread on the shelf?
Everybody goes to Walmart.
Huh? We hit pick back, and we hit boot hang with a loaf, and we drive one to bed. We're trying to find a loaf of bread. Bottle of pop. Roll toilet paper. Hand sanitizer. They got a limit on the hand sanitizer again, y'all.
No, did
they? Not that yet. What'd you say? You said I'm not stepping into that. They got a limit on it again. You got my camera. You ain't got my camera. I took a picture of it down there in the box for a day. They got signs up all over the store. A limit on bleach, a limit on hand sanitizer, a limit on paper towels, a limit on cleaning products. I mean, it's posted all in the store. It's coming again.
Yeah.
We think we're home free. Go ahead and start stocking up a little bit because it's coming in. I didn't do none of that. When all this first started, we didn't stock up. We had probably 10 rows of toilet paper already. But you go down to the store, and there wasn't none down there.
Yeah.
What do you think is going to happen when the church is gone?
That.
Yeah, I believe the church is going to get raptured out.
Oh, yeah. Amen.
What do you think is going to happen when the church is gone? Now, when the church leaves, something else is going with it.
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Ghost is going with it. Because the Bible said that the Antichrist can't do anything until he that hindereth is taken out of the way. And that's the Holy Ghost. Right now, the Holy Spirit is protecting God's people.
Right.
See, we don't have nothing to fear. Through all this pandemic, we shouldn't have fear. The Holy Spirit's protecting us. He's got His hand on us. And God knew the day I was born how I was going to leave this world.
Amen.
Amen.
God knew the day I was born how long I was going to live.
Amen.
He knew from the moment that I come into this world who I was going to be, what I was going to be.
Amen.
That's why I don't complain about being tall. That's why I don't complain about losing hair. I don't complain about none of that. If I had my way about it, you know, Larry, you're looking at the limit. Bless his heart, his son back there, he just gets a good thrill out of looking down. I love you, bro. I come up to shake hands with him on a Sunday morning. I said, don't stand up. Every now and then he gets a make streak and he'll stand up. Yeah. So if I had my druthers, you know, I'd look him right in the eye. Yeah. But God made me what I am.
That's right. Amen.
Andy, little as much. Yeah, baby.
Yes,
little as much. And who defeated the giant?
Little David.
Little David. Not Big Fred. I love you, brother. Don't get mad at me now. Little David. Because Saul was a head taller than anybody else in that army.
Yeah.
He was a head taller than everybody. Just like you. He was a head taller than everybody. And he ran from the giant.
Yeah.
Little David ran right to it. Took a sling and a stone. And feebly brought him down. And then took his own sword and cut the giant's head off.
Yeah.
You see, little as much as God's in.
Amen.
You only knew. He asked the woman the question. If you only knew who it was that says to you, give me a drink, you'd ask him and he'd give you living water.
Amen.
1974, on the 1st of October, I walked down the aisle at Buffalo Valley Church, right down here on the hill. And I got to know who that was talking to that woman. I got to know that man. And Lord, I asked him, Lord, give me a drink of that water. You remember the woman asked him, said, or told him, said, Lord, give me a drink of that water that I don't come here to draw no more. He wasn't talking about that natural water. He said, go call your husband. I had no husband, Lord. You say, well, you had no husband. You had five husbands. You know that man you're living with? He's not your husband. Jennifer run up and tell him all about me. Somebody must have told him. You know, I don't know if anybody else had this experience or not, but when the preacher was preaching the night I got saved, I thought somebody went and told him all about me. Somebody had to tell him about me. Somebody told him how miserable I was and the kind of life I had. Somebody must have told on me. And somebody did tell on me, and it was the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Amen. He told me exactly what to preach and where it was going and who it's going to.
Amen.
And I'm so thankful because the devil put in my mind, get out that door. Get over here to the edge of the seat so you can get out that door. And I sat back, the second seat up in the back end of that church. That's where I was sitting. And I kept thinking at the beginning, at the very beginning of the service, I kept thinking, man, it's getting hot in here. I got to make my way out.
Yeah.
I gripped that seat. I shuffled my feet. I said, if anybody comes back here, they better not come back here and try to drag me to that altar. You know, the spirit of Satan was working on me, trying to get me not to hear the word of God.
Amen.
And just out of nowhere, my heart broke into a million pieces. And the realization sunk in that I was on a broad road leading to destruction.
Amen.
God was going to hell unless I did something about it. And it was something that mommy couldn't do for me.
Right, that's right.
I'd always called on my mom. Puppy love, when I first started thinking I was loving these little old girls and stuff, you know, they'd break my heart in two. I'd go to my mommy and she'd tell us, all right, bring more dishes. Don't worry about it. If she really cared about you, she would have done you that way. Mother, you always make me feel better.
Yeah.
You'd always rub your head. Roger was a grown man. He got his heart broken. He went to mother. He said, lay your head down on that, son. She just rubbed his head. She soothed him, made him feel better. He was talking about this just the other night. He said, mother made me feel better.
Yeah.
And that's the way a mother's love is. That's the way it should be.
Amen.
Daddy had to work 6 days a week, sometimes 16-hour shifts. We seldom ever saw him. He'd come in, go to bed. We seldom ever saw him. But my mom was always there. Through every scrape, through every disappointment of life, through every mistake. I'm going to tell y'all this, and then I'm going to hush since I'm talking about mother. I was 14 years old. And I had a brother-in-law, late homebird. He lived in Deep Holler. And I got into that homebird knowing that my mommy had told me never drink no alcohol. Yeah, she taught us right. We come to church with her. If we had a drug problem, she drug us to church. She drug us to Sunday school. She drug us to church. She drug us to church. And I got into that homework. And I got messed up. So somebody called my daddy. Told him. Probably my brother-in-law. And he sent Larry over there, my oldest brother, to get me. And he come over to Room Creek. I got in the car. And boy, he turned around on in that seat and he started pointing that finger at me. Of all Dad was going to do to me, going to beat you to death, boy, you deserve it. And he got on my nerves so bad that I said, stop his car and let me out. Because you know how it is when you're kind of crazy anyway. He wouldn't stop, and I reached up front, opened the door, and bailed out. What a mistake. I wished I had. I rode over the creek, cut up, dirty, nasty. I got up out of there. He hollered back at me and said, that's all right, you stay there, boy. I'm going to go get Daddy and we'll be back. And he left. So I got up and I walked down to Jocko Fleming's house. Y'all know the Fleming's? It's over at old DU school. That little house that sat in there, only about 6 foot tall. The house was real short. You had to duck your head and you went in there. I was 15. I wasn't even 6 foot tall myself. But I walked down there to that house. And they were my friends. They were my buddies. And I told them what's going on. And you know that old woman and that man went in there and put on eggs and bacon and biscuits. Homemade biscuits. I'm talking about 10 o'clock at night. I said, come on in here, you put his pants on, you go in there and take a bath. I washed my hair. I don't know how long it took Larry to go over and get Daddy, but I had time to do all that bathing and cleaning. And they had a tray that big sitting on the table when I come in there. Eggs and bacon and everything. Let's sit down here. I sat down and I was eating. I said, come in, Mr. Adkins. I'm thinking I'm dead.
Yeah.
You know, he ain't no doubt about it. He's gonna kill him. He comes in there and he says, I just come to pick this boy up. And I said, well, you want something to eat before you leave? And, you know, chit chat and all that stuff. And make a long story short. Dad told me to get in the car, and I did. I didn't give him no back talk. He could point his finger if he wanted to. Larry didn't come back like that. He never said one word to me. All the way across the Kelly Mountain, all the way up to where I'm living at right now, he never said a word to me. Took me in the house. My mother was waiting. She had the old-fashioned dresser. Come in like that and down like that, and the mirror went up the back. And she was sitting up on that like a chair. And I walked in there. The hurt in her eyes hurt me worse than any woman she could have ever been. It broke my heart in pieces because I hurt my mother and I disappointed my mother who had never heard anybody. She looked at me and she said, did you learn a lesson? I said, yes, ma'am. She just turned and walked out of the room. I know she would have to cry. Looking back, well, I know she did. And you know what? Never disappointed her again, but I know her. I never disappointed her again. I never backtalked her. I never said no. Me and Georgia talked about this coming home from Tennessee. He said, my mama was alive. He's in his 60s. And she said, come over here, son. I'm going to give you a walk. He said, I walked right over there and said, go ahead.
Yeah. Amen.
I went around, I went back up, and I feel the same way. Yeah. If we only knew who Jesus was, I'm going to close this right now. If we only knew who Jesus was, we wouldn't carry these burdens. We wouldn't carry these problems.
Right.
We wouldn't carry these sicknesses and these illnesses and all this. We would turn it over to God and trust
Him. Amen.
If it takes me out, Brother Charlie said something to me on the phone. I called and talked to him about 2 hours ago. Alan has called him since too. He said, if this takes me out, God's been good to me.
Amen.
That's the way I got to go. I'm ready to go.
Yeah.
I don't want to go, right. But I'm ready to go. Now, if this takes me out, I'm ready.
Amen.
And I believe he's ready.
Amen.
You guys?
Amen.
I believe Brother Charlie's ready. I really do. Not in no hurry. I'm not in no hurry to go. But if the rapture happens, I'll be all I'll be jumping toward that cloud. But let's continue to pray for Brother Charlie.
Amen.
Pray to God. Give him all the comfort.
Amen.
They're going through a time. I went through it 6 times now, I believe it is, either 5 or 6 times with loved ones that had cancer, different types of cancer. And I've been through it. And I know how painful it is. And you get to a point to where you feel like
I believe Brenda made a statement the other day, sometimes she feels like she's all alone. And you don't, you get to that point where you feel like you're all alone. You feel like the church don't care, your family don't care, your friends don't care. And that's just the way it is. You get in a state of depression. We need to turn it over to God. We need to talk to God. And I ask God, please, comfort them too. And the ones that's going through the broken heart, going through cancer. We all know. None of us know what tomorrow holds.
That's right.
We may go to a doctor tomorrow and he may tell us, you got it. Right. It's a whole different ballgame when it comes to your house. I have all the faith in the world when I'm praying for you. I have all the faith when I pray for you. But when it comes to your house, you know what you need? You need the brothers and sisters.
Amen.
You need them.
Amen.
I have faith for you. Because when you was first diagnosed, what was your thought?
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Cancer. You hear the word cancer, death sentence. Not necessarily so. God is the healer of all things. He can make all creations. And I love the Lord, and I hope you got something out of it. I don't know if you're going to say it. But I want Kevin to come and give him a song. And we'll do this. If you're here in your estate, there's one or two that I don't know. If you're here in your estate, I'm going to open the altar up. You come down. You give your heart to Jesus. There's your time to run out. You don't have time to debate on this. You don't have time to halt between two opinions. You need to make a decision tonight. Because the Lord could come tonight. This world is falling. It's falling fast. You better get on board. That old ship is out. It's falling fast. If you're here and you don't know Jesus, this is an opportunity for you to come. And if you're here tonight and you're debating, I'm ready to hold on or to give up, you need to come down and ask God to renew your strength.
Amen.
If you're here tonight and you feel like I'm scared, I'm fearful of this virus or whatever it is, you need to come down and talk to the Lord about it.
Amen.
You need to talk to Jesus. A lot of people have called me. We've got, 80-some members on our book. And there's been probably 20% of them that said, well, I'm afraid to come back. And I said, well, you follow your heart. You do what you feel is right. I'm not going to tell you, come on back if you're afraid. And you're, but I believe we need to turn that fear over to the Lord.
Amen.
I believe we need to turn it over to the Lord. You say when you're ready. Church, will you stand with me just for a minute? We won't hold you very long. Just do this one song. If you're here and you need prayer, whether it be for sin, sickness, or anything that you're going to in your life, sit down your seat. Come down to an old-fashioned altar and say, church, pray with me. I need more strength. I need forgiveness. I need God to make a way for me in situations, circumstances. There's no shame in it. I was very proud of these two who came down and did what they did. The church was very proud of them. Family, y'all put it on. Yeah, I'm very proud of you, sir. And we're proud. The ones that went in the water hole today, I'm proud. I love you with all my heart, man. That thrilled me so much to be able. My friends, for all these years, it was an honor to baptize you. Grow up with the help. We've known each other since we were little kids. It was an honor to baptize you. Acquainted with Austin there. We didn't be good buddies. It was an honor, man. Really was. Hang on to God no matter what. No matter what. Hang on to God. We're almost home, church. We're almost home. Don't lose out now. We're almost there. It's like running a race and getting to where you see the finish line in sight and say, oh, I'm just going to sit down and quit. No, you'll keep going toward that finish line, won't you? Anybody need prayer? These are up here tarrying right now at this altar. Praise.
God help them. Help them, Lord, to have the courage and the strength. If you need more zeal in your Christian life, have you let the devil steal your joy? Take it back. Don't let him have it. As he took your shout. I believe with all my heart that we're going to see people renew themselves with God. I think we're going to see folks that have a need in the Lord that are going to come. God bought it back. See, his only begotten Son that bought it back.
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow.
God bless him.
The sun
has
closed to shine.
Enjoy the rest of the song.
God who called me here. Will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. Lord, you are forever mine.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Praise God. Tomorrow night, being the Lord's will, Brother Kevin will be doing the preaching, Brother Tommy's going to lead services, and Brother Roger will be doing the singing, being the Lord's will. We got a little list made up here to try to keep things as orderly as we can. Invite your friends, invite your neighbors, invite your family. Come out to the house of God. Let's show the world, let's show the government, let's show the devil that there's still a few people that wants to have church.
Amen.
And we're still going to have church.
Amen.
And we're going to still worship God in spirit and truth. And come out. Come out. And support this revival. All right. All hearts and minds clear.
Brother Bob.
Yes.
I'll be wanting to know what you sang. First song.
You are welcome.
Starlight shines. The night is still. Shepherds watch from the hill. I'll close my eyes.
No,
bless your heart.
Perfect child gently waits. A mother bends to kiss God's face. I close my eyes, see the night when love was born. Angels fill the midnight sky. They sing hallelujah, he is Christ our King. Emmanuel, Prince of Peace, love's come down for you and me. Heaven's gift, the holy spark, to let the way inside their hearts. The world was changed forevermore. When love was born, I close my eyes, see the night.
A lot of people are training their kids in different ways. We need to train them in the way that we have when we go. And anytime the children want to sing here, we're going to let them sing. Amen. All right, it's my spirit. All right, we will reference the Lord. If you want to stand, you can. Brother Allen, would you dismiss us in one prayer, please?
Thank you.